Hello friends, how are you all? My name is Arshad Dwivedi and I welcome you back to my video. So in this video friends, I will be talking to you regarding a personality named William Wilberforce. William Wilberforce was acting in the time period of 1759 to 1833. He was born in 1759 and died on 26th of July 1833. So he was a very prominent personality as far as anti-slavery is concerned. He throughout his life campaigned against the slavery, the slave trade. Initially, he put in efforts to abolish the slave trade, and then finally, till his death, you can say the complete slavery, abolition on the complete slavery was there in the whole British Empire throughout the world. So this was his contribution to the cause of human society. And there's also a very phrase which is very much associated with his life. You may choose to look the other way, but you can never say again that you did not know. Now, what do we mean by this phrase? This phrase simply means, friends, that for example, we are looking at an issue. And we think that if we are going to involve us into that issue, that will be a little bit inconvenient to us. Or involving us in that issue is not of much benefit to us, but yes, it can benefit the society as a whole. So in many cases, people will think that I will not involve myself with that issue. But somewhere down within us, we will think that it was morally correct to involve us with that issue. And if we ignored that issue, if we started focusing on something else, then it will haunt us for our whole life. So this is basically what this saying means. So before starting with this video, friends, before starting talking about Mr. Wilberforce, I would like to tell you that if you want to follow me, the link of my Instagram profile is given in the description box below. Also, friends, this video is in English. If you want to watch the Hindi version of the video, the link of that is also given in the description box below. So first of all, introduction about William Wilberforce. He was born on 24th of August 1759 in Hull, it is in Yorkshire. Then he died July 29th 1833 in London. Okay, he was a British politician, philanthropist, and from 1787 he was prominently involved to abolish the slave trade. He first abolished the slave trade, and after that he abolished slavery in all the British overseas possessions. So if you talk about his personal life, friends, he married Barbara Ann Spooner. She was an evangelical Christian on 30th of May 1797. And the couple loved each other a lot and they were loyal to each other. They were blessed with 6 children. From his birth, Mr. William Wilberforce was very weak. He had a very poor eyesight. His bad health troubled him throughout his life. And at the end point of his life, he also lost his eyesight. He became very, very ill. Then in 1833, he contracted influenza and was not able to recover from influenza. He finally died on 29th of July. Sorry, friends, it was 29th of July on which he died, 1833. On 26th of July, the Anti Slavery Abolition Act was passed by House of Commons. So that is why I said 26th. Actually, he died on 29th of July, 1833. Okay, friends. Now, from the start, we are going to talk about Mr. William Wilberforce. He was born on 24th of August 1759. He was the son of Robert Wilberforce and Elizabeth Pitt. Now, what happened, friends, that his father, Robert Wilberforce, he died in 1768. Now, when his father died in 1768, he was put under the guidance of his aunt and uncle. Okay, now when he was living with his aunt and uncle, from 1768 to 1771, he was living with his aunt and uncle. Now his aunt and uncle, they were non-conformist in their approach. Non-conformist means that they no doubt adhered to the principles of Christianity, but they had some amount of logicalness in their approach. They didn't blindfoldly follow the Christian tradition. They actually followed the Christian tradition, but they applied a lot of logic to it. That is, they were not ready to adhere to the superstitions that were widely prevalent in the Christian religion. So when his mother, Mr. William Wilberforce's mother, saw, Miss Elizabeth Bird saw that his son was actually adhering to this non-conformist relatives, she went and she took back her child at the age of 12 back to Hull. So from she brought her child William Wilberforce from London to Hull again, because her mother wanted that that Mr. William Wilberforce, he acquires Anglican church traditions. And that is why her mother brought her back to Hull. Okay, friends. Now, in Hull, obviously the teachings and the school life of Mr. William Wilberforce started. So when he was involved in school life, and then he went for Harbour's higher studies in Cambridge University, St. John's College. So the religious favor, the religious fervor, the religious stint that was initiated inside Mr. William Wilberforce at a very young age, that slowly subsided. And obviously he started associated himself with social outings of his friends. He started living a hedonistic lifestyle, but actually he distanced himself from doing extreme, that is from extreme drinking, from extreme partying. He distanced himself from it, but yes, he participated in the social outings of the college. He was very much liked in college, and one thing which separated him from the rest of the students was that he had a very excellent oratory skills. His conversational skills were very good. He had a very pleasing voice. Okay, and there at college, he befriended his one friend whose name was William Pitt the Younger. And you will know, friends, that this William Pitt the Younger in his future life is going to become the Prime Minister of England. So he remained a good friend of William Pitt for whole life. And Mr. William Pitt and Mr. William Wilberforce, they supported each other for a very long time. However, when the war with France started in 1793, okay, then obviously there was some sort of a fight between Mr. William Pitt and Mr. William Wilberforce. There was some sort of grudge in between them. But yes, before 1793, before the French Revolution, before this Napoleon, the oncoming of Napoleon and war with France, they were a good friends. Now, this is the home of Mr. William Wilberforce. There is a statue of Mr. William Wilberforce outside the Wilberforce House. Here, he was born in Hull. It has now become a tourist place, and it is also very much important in the cultural history of England, friends. Okay. Now, Mr. William Wilberforce and Mr. William Pitt, they both studied at St. John's College, friends. And after that, in 1780, both Mr. William Wilberforce and Mr. William Pitt entered the House of Commons. Okay. Now, in 1780, the age of Mr. William Wilberforce was 21 years. He was born in 1759. In 1780, he was 21 years old. He spent around £8,000 to win a seat in his native Hull constituency of Parliament. He finally won it, but he won it as an independent. Mr. William Wilberforce didn't associate himself with any particular political party. There were two main political parties at that time. One was the Tory party, one was the Whig party. One was Tory party, T-O-R-Y, and one was Whig party. Okay, so he didn't associate himself either with the Tory party or Whig party. And he joined Parliament as an independent. But there is a big, criticism of Mr. William Wilberforce is that despite being an independent, he favored the party who was in power. For example, when the Tory party was in power, he supported the Tory party. When the Whig party was in power, he supported the Whig party. So people criticized him, the member of parliament criticized him that he is not consistent in his approach. But there were many good things about Mr. William Wilberforce. He had excellent oratory skills. He was an influential speaker. He had a strong sense of humor, strong sense of wit. And he was known in political circles for his fluency, for his excellent speaking power. And for a leader to be successful, friends, for a successful leader, one thing which cannot be compromised upon is his speaking power. Because through your speaking power, you can show your leadership. You can induce your crowd towards yourself. Then what happened, friends? From 1780 to 1784, he was an MP from Hull. Then the general elections of 1784 came. Okay. And in the general election of 1784, he fought as a candidate for the county of Yorkshire. And he also won that seat. And he returned to the House of Commons as an MP for Yorkshire on 6th of April 1784. Then what happened, friends? There is one thing that at this point in his life, around 1784, he went on to a Europe tour with his sister and mother. Now, when Mr. William Wilberforce on this tour of Europe with his sister and mother, his religious stint came back inside him. During his tour, he was reading a book, an evangelical book named as The Rise and Progress of Religion in the Soul. So this book he read, and this book and also his European tour, his experiences of the European tour again induced him towards evangelical Christianity. So he started living a religious life slowly. Okay, he started rising early in the morning, he started studying Bible in the morning, he lost interest in drinking, he stopped drinking, he, you can say, stopped playing these card games, and he committed himself to the cause of God. He became a devout Christian for the remainder of his life. But despite being a devout Christian, he was also under the influence of one Sir John Newton. John Newton was a leading Anglican churchman of that day. So despite of all this, despite of leaning towards Christianity, he decided that he will play a proper role in politics and he will continuous work for social reforms in the British society. So despite being, you know, induced towards evangelical Christianity, he remained devoted to social causes, friends. So this is one more information about Mr. William Wilberforce. Then came something special, that is Anti Slavery Society. Now there were, what happened, friends, in 1787, this Mr. William Wilberforce, he helped to form a society named as Reformation of Manners. It was also known as the Proclamation Society and the Society for Effecting the Abolition of the Slave Trade. It was also known as Anti-Slavery Society. Now, who were the associates of Mr. William Wilberforce in it? There were Thomas Clarkson, Granville Sharp, Henry Thornton, Charles Grant, Edward James Elliot, Zachary Macaulay, James Stephen. They were also known, all known as saints. Okay. So, all of these people were with Mr. Wilberforce. And Mr. Wilberforce was their acknowledged leader. Okay. Now, what happened, friends? That in this 1787, this society, Anti-Slavery Society, was formed. And through this Anti-Slavery Society, Mr. Wilberforce actively started involving himself for helping the cause of anti-slavery. He wanted this slavery thing to go from the society. In 1781, he was awarded a BA degree, friends. In 1788, he bagged a MA degree. This was one more educational, you know, achievements which happened in his life, friends. Okay. Then what happened? Slowly, time passed. Okay. Before completely involving himself in this cause of anti-slavery, friends, Mr. Wilberforce wanted to know completely about the slave trade, completely about this slavery thing in the society. So what he did, friends, that he befriended one of his friends. Okay, his friend name was Thomas Clarkson. Thomas Clarkson was an alumni of Cambridge University, and Thomas Clarkson was a subject expert of this slave trade. So Thomas Clarkson taught Mr. Wilberforce a lot about the slave trade. This Thomas Clarkson gave evidence to Mr. Wilberforce that what is the ground position of the slave trade in England, how the working conditions, the living conditions of the slaves in England is so bad. And in March 1787, Mr. Wilberforce decided that I am going to bring this cause of slave trade, I will try to stop this activity of slave trade by involving myself in the activities of the parliament. Because obviously, Mr. Wilberforce was a member of the parliament. He was a very influential member. He had excellent oratory skills and he was in the correct position. Because in order to abolish this slave trade, the best place to abolish this was the parliament. Because parliament had the power to pass a law to finish this pathetic thing at that point of time. This is one photo which was designed at that point of time by Josiah Wedgwood. It says, "Am I not a man and a brother?" So this was the, you can say, this photo very well describes the situation of blacks at that point of time. And this photo was released as a part of anti-slavery campaign in 1787, friends. Okay. So first of all, we are going to see what was the early parliamentary action in it. So in 1789, what Mr. Wilberforce did, he introduced 12 resolutions against the slave trade. And at that point of time, he gave many eloquent speeches in the House of Commons, and it is being said that those eloquent speeches have been one of the greatest speeches ever given in the House of Commons by any individuals. So this was how those speeches were was described by those time newspapers. So 12 resolutions were being introduced inside the House of Commons by Mr. William Wilberforce to stop the slave trade. Also, he advocated openly against the slave trade in the House of Commons. Okay, slowly, slowly, this thing came forward in 1789. This first speech was made, and slowly, 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 he made many speeches in the Parliament. For the very first time in 1791, Mr. William Wilberforce introduced the first parliamentary bill whose aim was to abolish the slave trade in British Empire. So this was the first time in which a parliamentary bill was introduced in the Parliament to abolish the slave trade. However, there were also many people inside the Parliament who didn't wanted this thing to get abolished, who wanted slavery to continue. And these people, they were actually known as anti-abolitionists. Obviously, abolitionists were those who wanted to abolish slavery, and anti-abolitionists were those who didn't wanted to abolish slavery. So those people who were against abolishing slavery, they were also very strong, and they were very well organized inside the Parliament. So when this first parliamentary bill was introduced by Mr. Wilberforce to abolish this slavery thing, it was defeated. 163 people voted for continuing slavery, and 88 people voted for discontinuing this slave trade. So basically, this, first of all, you need to understand, friends, that this parliamentary bill was introduced to abolish the slave trade. It was not there to abolish the slavery. It was there to abolish the slave trade. And finally, you will see that in 1807, this slave trade will be abolished, and slavery will be abolished on 1833. So this first bill in Parliament, which was introduced in 1791, this was actually to stop the slave trade. It was defeated. Okay, then again in 1792, William Wilberforce organized lots of support from British subjects. Hundreds of thousands of British signatures were being taken. Petitions were being signed so that slave trade can be ended. But obviously, those people who opposed the abolition of slavery, they were very, very organized, and they didn't let it happen. Okay, then the first free colony of the blacks from United Kingdom, the Nova Scotia and Jamaica, it was being established in 1792, and Mr. William Wilberforce supported the establishment of these colonies financially. Okay, then again he introduced an abolition bill, and this abolition bill was against rejected. Okay, then friends, what happened in 1793? One thing happened, one incident happened, that was the outbreak of war with France. Now when this outbreak of war with France was there, the whole national focus shifted to war with Napoleon. Okay, now this Napoleon was very much active at that point of time in total France, in total Europe, you can say, and Britishers and other powers who were against France wanted to defeat it at any cost. So at this point of time, when this war was going on between England and France, it is very proper and logical to think that obviously this matter of abolishing slave trade took a back seat. It became a secondary priority, and the first priority and the national priority was to subvert the threat from Napoleon-led France. Okay, this war came on, went on till 1805. Then what happened that in 1804, June 1804, Mr. William Wilberforce again introduced a bill in the House of Commons. Now in House of Commons, this was also an anti-abolition bill. So this anti-abolition bill was passed in House of Commons, successfully passed in House of Commons, but it failed in the House of Lords. So it didn't become a law. Then in 1807, the Lord Granville, who was the Prime Minister at that point of time of England, he introduced Lord Wilberforce Abolition Bill in the House of Lords. And it was passed in the House of Lords, then it went to the House of Commons, and it also passed in the House of Commons, and in House of Commons it was passed with a huge majority. 283 people voted in favor of abolishing slave trade, not slavery, slave trade. And this bill received the royal assent of 25th of March 1807 and became a law. That is, now slave trade was banned from the British Empire. Okay, then slowly, slowly, when the slave trade was banned, The next thing which Mr. Wilberforce targeted was the abolition of slavery. He dedicated now his the remaining of his life to the abolition of slavery, friends. Now, at this point of time, Mr. Wilberforce was also trying to do some social changes in the society. Mr. Wilberforce knew that in order to empower people, it is very important to educate people. Education is a big tool, because if the people are educated, they will be able to get themselves out of poverty. And if they are able to get themselves out of poverty, they can fight this slave trade quite well. So obviously, in this venture, he was supported by a reformer named Hannah More. So Hannah More used to provide children with education in reading, personal hygiene, religion. So Mr. Wilberforce was also associated with the Royal Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. Then Mr. Wilberforce, he encouraged Christian missionaries to grow to India and convert people to Christianity. So obviously he was a devout Christian. By 1812, his health started deteriorating. So in 1812, he left his MP seat of Yorkshire and he joined the MP seat of Rotten Borough. Okay. Also, Mr. Wilberforce, he wanted to change the political and social order through Christianity. And he wanted to improve the morals of the British society. The British society, according to him, was going through a lot of degeneration, and he wanted the Britishers to live a more moral life. And he advocated political and social changes in the British society, but he was against radical ways to do it. He was against radical changes in the British society. He was against revolution. He wanted everything to happen gradually. Okay. Now what happened then? These activities of Mr. William Wilberforce got him a lot of criticism also. Why? For example, there was one radical writer, William Corbett. William Corbett attacked Mr. Wilberforce, saying that Mr. Wilberforce is campaigning so high for the slave trade, and he is not saying anything for those Britishers who are living in pathetic conditions at home. Why? The Britishers were living in pathetic conditions at home. You very well know that in 1750, industrial revolution has started in England. In the London was filled with industries, the areas around London, the whole of England was going through industrial revolution. Heavy modernization, industrialization was going on. There were workers working in nurseries, and obviously they were living in very filthy, unsanitized conditions. They had to work 16 hours a day. So Mr. William Corbett criticized Mr. William Wilberforce, saying that why you are not saying anything for the British subjects who are subjected to such heavy cruelty. Okay. Then, friends, he also wanted to revitalize the church. He wanted the society should be more moral, society should be more harmonious. He wanted the status of religion in public and private life also. He wanted to spread the religion in upper and middle classes of society. And for that, in April 1797, he published A Practical View of Prevailing Religious System of Professed Christians in the Higher and Middle Classes of this Country, contrasted with Real Christianity. So these are all things that were done by him, friends. As I've already told you, that he wanted to morally reform the Christian society. According to him, Christian society was degenerating a lot, and in addition to stopping the slave trade in the British society, he also wanted to stop the moral degeneration of the British society. And he himself practiced that moral ethics that he wanted other peoples to do. Okay, so slowly his health was degrading, friends, and in 1824 his health degraded a lot more. So when he 1824 he was seriously ill, he resigned from his Yorkshire parliamentary seat. And despite of the fact that he resigned from his Yorkshire parliamentary seat, he continued his fight against stopping slavery. Okay, friends, and finally the last anti-slavery speech with Mr. William Wilberforce gave was in April 1833. It was at a public meeting in Maidstone, Kent. Okay, he also resigned from his seat in Parliament, that I've already told you. Okay, finally, when he was about to die, friends, you know, he died on 29th of July 1833. 3 days before his death, the House of Commons passed the Abolition of Slavery Bill. 3 days before his death, abolition of slavery bill was passed by the House of Commons on 26th of July 1833. And 1 month after his death, friends, this abolition of slavery bill was also passed in the, the other house of the parliament, friends. That is the House of Lords. And finally, it became a law that is slavery was banned completely from the British Empire. And this was a big thing. You can say that this was a sort of gift which was given to Mr. William Wilberforce by the British Parliament, because the British Parliament wanted to recognize the efforts Mr. William Wilberforce made throughout his life to stop slave trade from the British Empire. Okay, so this is what he did. You know, on 29th of July, when Mr. Wilberforce died, he was in Cadogan Place in London at his cousin's home. Now, when the funeral thing came, Mr. William Wilberforce had said that he wanted to be buried with his sister and daughter at Stoke Newington, just north of London. But the leading members of the House of Parliament, who respected Mr. Wilberforce a lot, they said that a grand honor should be given to Mr. William Wilberforce and he should be buried in Westminster Abbey. Now, in Westminster Abbey, the great personalities of UK are buried. So the family finally agreed to this proposal, and on 3rd of August 1833, Wilberforce was buried in the north transept of the Westminster Abbey, just close to his very good friend William Pitt the Younger, who was the Prime Minister. Okay, friends, William Pitt died in around 1806. So this is the complete life history. This is, you can say, the photo of Mr. William Wilberforce. He is buried in Westminster Abbey next to William Pitt. The memorial statue, this is by Samuel Joseph. Okay, it was erected in 1840 in the North Choir, Assel. Okay, so whenever you will go to Westminster Abbey, you will see this statue of Mr. William Wilberforce. His life's works, his books, whatever he has done, his speeches have been highly commemorated throughout the world. He has a great standing within the black community. The black community respects him a lot, as he had done a lot for them. Okay, and this, I already told you, this seated statue was commissioned by Mr. Samuel Joseph in 1840. This is a memorial of Mr. William Wilberforce on the grounds of Hull College. This was erected in 1834. So this was a complete life of Mr. William Wilberforce. He is a great personality, was very instrumental in stopping the slave trade, because when British Empire stopped this slave trade, abolished this slave trade, there was a big call for abolishing this slave trade all around the world, and slowly the slave trade was abolished from the complete world. So thank you for watching this video, friends. I hope this video was of help to you. This video gave you some information about Mr. Wilberforce. The information that I have given you, you can use in Ethics Paper 4 of UPSC, and it is also good for your general knowledge. So please share this video, subscribe to my channel, tell me through your comments how you like this video, and subscribe to your social media profile and refer it to your friends. So thank you for watching, friends. Have a great day.